Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Murder on Cape Cod by Maddie Day. Narrated by Rachel Dulude. Chapter 1. It's the little signs that end up meaning something. The fog. One man's odd restlessness. Another person's new confidence. The signs we ignore at our peril. The weekly meeting of the Cozy Capers book group was winding down in my brother's lighthouse, perched on a promontory in Cape Cod's hamlet of Westham. Jin Malloy, owner of Salty Taffy's candy store, lifted her wine glass.
"Here's to a supercharged summer season."
"I'll drink to that." I, Mackenzie Almeida, matched my friend's gesture. I hoped the summer wouldn't be too rainy. I was lucky enough to own Max Bikes, a bike rental and repair shop, and we did a booming tourist business as long as the weather stayed fair. We shopkeepers depended on the 3-month surge of vacationers for a large chunk of our income. Tonight, at a little after 8, the lighthouse's arched windows stood open to the sea air, which blew in the damp scents of early June. The round rooms looked out onto the Atlantic Ocean, or would have if it weren't too foggy to see the water. Derrick Searle, my half-brother, hadn't contributed much to the cozy mystery discussion, instead drumming his fingers with a quick, nervous movement, gazing out the window into the pea soup. Earlier, he'd left the door to the lighthouse unlocked and had tacked up a note telling us to come in and start without him. He'd arrived out of breath after everyone else and without explanation, which was unfortunately typical of him. Now he puttered around, picking up wine glasses and plates, holding remnants of this week's treat. The members of the group took turns making a dish mentioned in the book under discussion. This week, the town clerk had made a couple of killer pizzas for us to share, since Sherry Harris's "I Know What You Bid" last summer featured an Italian restaurant where Sarah Winston, the garage sale maven protagonist, often ate. I stood to help Derrick, but he waved me away.
"I'll do it, sis,"
he said in a gruff tone. He was the private lighthouse's caretaker, and I knew he liked to keep the place tidy, a trait we shared. The group, 10 strong tonight, exchanged farewells and filed down the circular staircase. "What are we reading for next week?" I asked.
"Cracked to death, remember?"
Jin replied.
"That's right."
It was the third book in Cheryl Holland's Webb's Glass Shop Mysteries. The group had decided to begin this season with a book set in June, thus starting with last week's "I Know What You Bid" last summer, and then move ahead a month every week, so we'd go through an entire year by the end of August. Cracked was described as taking place during the dog days of summer. Our group, which read exclusively cozy mysteries, had contacted the author to make sure that meant July. She'd assured us it did. "See you in the morning, Jin," I called, and waved to the rest, who headed for their cars. Me, I began my short walk home along the biking walking trail that paralleled the coast. My shop was successful in part because of these paved trails that ran up and down the Cape, from Provincetown to Woods Hole. I tried to hurry, smiling to myself because my boyfriend was meeting me at home. Tonight, though, the trail between the lighthouse and my tiny house behind the bike shop was almost unnavigable. It wasn't long past sunset, but the fog was a wall of mist around me. I could barely see where I was going, and I felt my already curly hair gain a new layer of frizz. I hoped all this damp didn't seep through my roof. I'd called out Jake Lacey, a down-on-his-luck handyman, about his shoddy repair job earlier. I volunteered serving dinner on Tuesdays in the late afternoon at our neighbor's table, a food pantry and soup kitchen, where Jake was a regular customer.
"Got my check?"
he'd asked today as he handed me his plate. "I'm sorry, Jake, but you did a terrible job on my roof."
"It was true.
I'd hired him to replace some of the shingles on my micro house after they'd blown off in a storm. He'd left gaps, some of the replacement shingles were poorly nailed on, and he hadn't even cleaned up the scraps and debris when he left. I gave him my sternest look. I'll pay you after you've fixed the shingles and not before. The woman behind him in line had raised her eyebrows at my criticism, but didn't say anything. Norland Gifford, the volunteer on my right, who was our newly retired Westham police chief, cleared his throat. I guess I should have saved my comment for a more private setting. Except Jake hadn't gotten his back up like he had in the past when anyone criticized him. Instead, he lifted his pointed chin and waggled his head, wearing a smug expression on his worn face.
"I ain't gonna even need your money soon, Mac. You wait and see."
I peered at him for a second, having no idea what he meant. "Did you get full-time work?" He was known around town for not being able to hold down a job, which was the reason he was here getting free food, of course.
"Nah, this is better than no stinking job. It's good, wicked good."
He grabbed the plate of pasta and sauce I dished up and moved down to the salad section.
"That's great,"
I'd called after him. There went my chance at a decent repair job from Jake. I guess I'd have to find somebody else since I wasn't going to do it myself. I could tune up a bicycle like nobody's business. But when it came to hammers and nails, I was all thumbs. And usually both of them got a good self-delivered whack within minutes of attempting anything in the field of carpentry. Now I found the turn from the bike trail to the pathway that cut up to Main Street. Near the end of the path, a hedge of scrubby coastal Rosa Rugosa separated the walkway from my postage stamp of a yard. The fragrant scent from the just-blooming native shrub mixed with the salt air and reminded me of my childhood here on the Cape. I slowed as I rounded a bend. I was scanning through the mist for the opening that would let me through the wall of roses when I tripped. The obstacle in my path, oddly both soft and solid, was a sizable one. I yelled, arms windmilling like in a vintage cartoon. The air gave me nothing to grab hold of, and I landed on my hands and elbows. I glanced down and back to see my knees resting on Jake.
"Gah!"
I shrieked and scrambled forward off of him. I crouched in place, my heart beating like the timpani in the Cape Symphony. Jake lay on his front with his head half turned toward me, lips pulled back in a grimace, eyes unblinking.
"Jake,"
I called. "Jake, are you all right?" He didn't respond. I inched closer and couldn't detect any signs of breathing. I touched his temple, but I didn't feel a pulse under his too cool skin. His skinny legs were splayed at an odd angle, and his back was still, too still. No breaths moved it up and down. He was never going to enjoy another free spaghetti dinner or anything else. Jake Lacey was dead. Chapter 2. I pushed up to standing and pulled my phone out of the small bag I always wore when I went outside. My skin turned numb as I jabbed at 911, my shaking finger slipping a couple of times until the call connected. Jake's straggly light brown hair lay in skinny strands wet from the fog. The color of his beat-up old work coat almost matched his hair. I couldn't see any wounds, no blood stained his coat or marred his skin. I'd never seen a body before, not even an animal except roadkill, and then it was from the window of a car. My mother's parents had passed away before I was born, my other grandfather had died when I was traveling abroad, and we'd never had pets at home because of my allergies. What happened to Jake? Did he have a heart attack? A drug overdose? Did he even do drugs? When the dispatcher asked what my emergency was, I said, "There's a dead person. It's Jake Lacey." I managed to keep myself from shrieking again. I was desperate to get home. My house was only a few yards away. I wanted to lock the door and pretend this never happened. But I couldn't. I was a responsible adult, and a body on the path was out of order. I didn't like disorderly things.
"What is your location, ma'am?"
she asked. "I'm on the path behind the bike shop."
"What town, ma'am, and what's the name of the shop?"
The dispatcher's voice was infinitely patient. "Oh, yeah." The local police used a regional dispatch center. "Sorry, Westham, Max Bikes." I gave her the address.
"And how do you know this person is dead?"
One of those awful catastrophe giggles threatened to burble up. I swallowed it down. "He's not breathing and his skin is cold. It hardly even feels like skin." I turned away from the sight of his body. I had to.
"Do you feel safe?"
she asked. "Yes." After a beat, it occurred to me to add, "Why shouldn't I?" I gave a quick glance around the fog-shrouded path that looked like a scene in a mystery filmed on the Scottish moors. Shouldn't I feel safe? Did she mean someone had killed Jake? That was awful. Murder? Here? I'd never felt myself in danger in Westham, not when I was little, not since I'd been back. I knew some of the bigger towns on the Cape were plagued with higher crime rates than we had. Just because the long, curving peninsula was a scenic tourist destination didn't make Cape Cod immune from robbery, addiction, domestic abuse, and other bad things. On the contrary. But they mostly didn't happen in my town, as far as I knew, anyway. Jake had probably felt safe, too. The thought stabbed me with sadness for him. I shivered from the shock as well as the cool damp of the night. It had still been warm and sunny when I'd left for the Cozy Capers meeting, and I wore only jeans and a Falmouth Road Race t-shirt with my sandals.
"Is anyone with you?"
the dispatcher asked, startling me. I'd forgotten she was on the line. "No." "Nobody living, that is."
"Officers are on their way. Do you feel comfortable staying where you are?"
"I guess. I'd feel a lot more comfortable once Jake was someone else's responsibility."
"Please keep this call open until the officers arrive," she instructed.
"Okay." I didn't dare stash the phone, for fear I'd press the wrong button. So I stood, holding it, like an unfortunate statue. The fog damped all sounds. But a dog barked faintly in the distance, and a big truck downshifted out on the highway a few miles away. It seemed selfish to feel sorry for myself, but I wished I'd never found Jake. Since I had, I rued not leaving my back porch light on. If someone had killed Jake, they might still be around. My breath grew shallow. I glanced quickly behind me on the trail, but, of course, I wasn't able to see a thing through the pea soup. I couldn't wait for this nightmare to be... "Mac?" A deep voice called. My boyfriend appeared in the gap in the hedge.
"Who are you talking?"
Tim Brunel's voice trailed off as he spied Jake.
"Is that Jake Lacey? He doesn't look good."
Tim hurried through the opening in the bushes, made one giant step over Jake's body, and took my face in both hands.
"Are you all right?"
I gazed 6 inches up into his tanned, concerned face. "I'm all right, kind of, but..." I gestured at the ground without really looking. "Jake isn't..." I could finally hear a siren growing closer. It was about time. A couple of minutes later, the path was transformed. A cruiser had rolled down the trail, barely fitting onto the narrow path, just. The police car now trained spotlights on Jake's body. 2 bag-carting EMTs rushed in from the street and then stopped rushing. Ambulance lights strobed over the tops of the buildings from the direction of the town's main drag. A bicycle patrol officer in a uniform polo shirt and black shorts leaned his bike against the hedge, pulled purple gloves out of a back pocket, and squatted next to Jake. Another officer was already stringing yellow plastic police line do not cross tape over the path behind me. Tim held my cold hand in his big, warm one. He was a tall man with luscious lips, dark blonde hair to his shoulders, and well-toned abs, but Right now, what mattered was the comfort of him standing beside me. Victoria Leighton, the recently promoted Westham chief of police, stood facing Tim and me. Victoria had pulled her white blonde hair back into a neat bun, the way she always wore it, and her petite figure was trim in the navy uniform of the town's police force. "You simply happened across Mr. Lacey here," she said, blinking and setting her lips. She and I had been high school classmates, but not friends, and I remembered that look from 20 years ago. I let out a breath. "Yes, I was walking home from the lighthouse," I pointed behind me, "and I tripped over Jake. I wasn't looking down, and the fog was so thick I didn't see him."
"You didn't see anyone else in the vicinity?" Victoria asked. "Hear any noises?"
"Nope. Nobody and nothing."
"You, Mr. Brunel?"
Victoria turned her all-business gaze on him. "Did you also trip over the body?"
"No, ma'am."
Tim was unfailingly polite and unshakable.
"I was supposed to meet Mac at her house when I got there."
He pointed toward my backyard.
"I heard her talking, so I came through the opening in the hedge and found her here."
"When was that?" Victoria asked. "I'd just finished talking with the dispatcher," I offered. "As soon as Tim showed up, I heard the siren. You got here maybe 2 minutes later." Westham is such a small town. Victoria almost could have walked here faster.
"When was the last time either of you saw Mr. Lacey alive?"
I gestured for Tim to go first. He shook his head.
"Not in the last couple of days. On Sunday, I was doing a training run along the water, and I saw Jake with some woman on the hill down near Westham Point."
"I saw him at the soup kitchen this afternoon," I said, "at around 5 o'clock.
"The one at the UU church?"
"Yes. The Unitarian Universalist Church, where my father, Joseph Almeida, was minister in chief."
"And Mr. Lacey seemed well?"
Victoria cocked her head, looking diagonally up at me since I was 6 inches taller than her.
"Yes."
I thought back to the food line. "He seemed happy about something."
"What was that something?"
She raised eyebrows so pale you could hardly see them. I cleared my throat. "I told him I wouldn't pay him for the lousy job he did replacing some shingles on my house until he fixed them right away, but he said that soon he wasn't going to need my money."
"Interesting. Sounds like you were angry with him."
"I wasn't angry, but I was curious about why he wasn't going to need what I owed him. Usually he was on my case about paying him promptly. I asked if he'd gotten a full-time job, and he said no, that it was better than a job, that it was wicked good." His words. She crossed her arms over her chest.
"I don't suppose you got so mad you wanted to harm him, did you?"
"What? That's crazy. I told you I wasn't mad at him. I was unhappy about the quality of his work, but..." "Wait." I stared at her. "Do you think someone killed Jake?" I rubbed the moisture off my inch-long curls. "On purpose?" Like what the dispatcher had alluded to when she asked if I felt safe. She straightened, which really didn't give her much extra height at all.
"Not necessarily, but it was an unattended death, and that makes it a suspicious one. The coroner will determine means of death in due time. My job is to ask the questions."
"Chief,"
the kneeling officer called.
"You both stay right here,"
she instructed us before hurrying to his side. She knelt on one knee next to him.
"What do you have?"
Tim extended a strong arm around my shoulders, and I watched the bike officer turn Jake onto his back. My breath rushed in with a rasping sound, and my hand involuntarily covered my mouth. Through the mist-laced light from the spotlights, I could see a knife embedded to its hilt in the tender side of Jake's neck. I'd seen that knife before, with its 4-inch carved wooden handle. I'd last seen it embedded in the guts of a striped bass, held by my brother Derrick. Chapter 3. Tim and I nestled on my 2-person sofa an hour later. I'd tucked it in the nook under the sleeping loft. A tall, narrow bookcase to our right was jammed 3 layers deep with cozy mysteries, and a low cabinet to my left held a lamp on top and storage underneath. A small coffee table in front of us also doubled as a bookcase, with a double-sided shelf below the tabletop. With only 400 square feet, I had to make every inch count. Usually, my cozy home gave me a warm, fuzzy feeling inside. Not tonight. Cheers. He held up the glass of Cabernet Sauvignon he'd brought. Even though it's not a cheery night. I clinked and sipped before speaking. No, it's not. The fog still filled the air outside, and I was glad for the electric heater on the wall, even though it was June. Not cheery at all, in more ways than one. Victoria had kept us at the crime scene for another half hour, so it was already past 9:30. She'd said a detective would want to talk to me tomorrow. Belle, my African gray parrot, hopped onto Tim's shoulder.
Give me a kiss, handsome.
She cocked her head, making a kissing sound.
Give me a kiss, huh?
Tim almost spilled his wine. He laughed so hard.
Did you teach her that?
I giggled. No, but I've said it to you before. Belle, the only pet I wasn't allergic to, had been with me since I moved back to Westham a year ago. I'd gotten her when I'd graduated from college. These birds lived for decades, and my parents had kept her during my years abroad. Go on, she won't stop until you at least make the sound back. Tim rolled his eyes, but blew Belle a kiss.
Mmm.
The parrot nodded her head.
How about a treat? Give me a peanut, please.
Belle, I scolded. No treats before bed. Go get in your cage. She gave me a wolf whistle, but obeyed, hopping to the bookcase and then to her cage. In a compact space like this, she didn't have far to go. Oh, well. I swirled the wine in the glass, watching the red trail down the sides. But that reminded me too much of blood. When I shuddered, Tim squeezed my shoulder.
Thinking about Jake?
Of course. I set the glass down and twisted to face him, wrapping my arms around my knees. You saw the knife? That means he was murdered. Do you know of anybody who had it in for him? Except I can't believe someone would go so far as to actually kill another person, right here in Westham.
Murders happen all the time. You read books about them every week.
But those are fiction. They're made up. I read stories that come out of an author's imagination, Tim. They're not real life.
Ever hear of the news?
He kept his voice gentle.
Dorchester, Chicago, L.A., Miami. And it's not only big cities. Even in little towns, people are murdered.
He sipped from his own glass. I guess. Jake said he was going to be coming into some money soon. I wonder where he thought it was coming from.
My first thought was blackmail.
My eyes went wide. Blackmail? Like he knew dirt on somebody and was going to make them pay for not telling? Tim bobbed his head up and down once. Doesn't that happen only in books, too?
No. I read about a guy doing exactly that just last year. Got caught, finally. I guess he was lucky he didn't get killed for doing it.
I grimaced.
So did I detect some tension between you and the police chief?
He nudged my foot with his knee. I rolled my eyes. Yeah, she never did like me. She thought we were rivals in high school.
Were you?
We both got top grades. She was the top competitor on debate team. I was president of the math club. I didn't care, but she always had a thing about me. I lifted a shoulder and dropped it. It was ages ago. I still don't care, as long as she doesn't accuse me of murder based on some imagined slight from decades past.
She can't do that. They need evidence to make an arrest. They don't have any.
I guess. I frowned. Should I tell him I thought the knife was Derrick's? Maybe it was a common haft. Maybe dozens of people on the Cape use them to gut fish. Just because I'd never seen one like that other than my brother's didn't mean his was the only one. I was going to keep that bit to myself for now. Tim stroked my foot.
I bet you were cute in high school.
I'd met the hunky baker shortly after I'd opened the shop, almost exactly a year ago. He'd been crazy about me from day one, wooing me in the bike shop with pastries and jokes until I consented to go out with him.
I mean, in a different way than you're cute now,
he hurried to add.
In a young girl way, not in a gorgeous woman way.
Gorgeous woman? Hardly. I was fit, almost wiry, with a speedy metabolism that meant I never had to worry about my weight. And I thought I was reasonably attractive, but not exactly model material. I guess I was cute if you think geeky is cute. I wore glasses and loved numbers. I read a lot. I didn't go on a date until college.
Did you dance or play sports or anything?
I wasn't bad at softball, but I was really good at climbing. I gazed around my welcoming space, the framed blue tie temple rubbing on the opposite wall, a colorful hand-painted Cape Verdean market scene next to it, the bright woven rug on the hardwood floor. Nowhere to climb in here except up to the sleeping loft.
Like rock climbing?
He asked. Yes, and indoor, too. I'm kind of fearless that way.
Honey, you wouldn't catch me going up a perpendicular wall for anything. I get nervous around heights.
I smiled. That's because you're so tall.
Did you ever fall off?
Only when I was learning. And I was wearing a harness. No harm done. My smile slid away. I can't stop thinking about poor dead Jake. You told Victoria you saw him with a woman out near Westham Point the other day. Was it somebody from here in town?
I didn't recognize her, but I wasn't that close. Her profile looked sort of businessy, though. You know, blazer, heels, that kind of thing.
I nodded slowly. She hadn't been into the bakery? Most out-of-towners stop in at some point, don't they?
Mac, half the time I'm in the back baking. I don't see all the customers who come through. You know that. And unlike you, I didn't grow up here. It's not a big town, but I've never set eyes on half the year-round residents, not to mention summer folks.
I know. This murder business was already frustrating. I'd have to find Derrick first thing tomorrow and make him look for his knife. Or ask him if he and Jake had had problems in the past. I didn't want to call him about it tonight, but I could see if the news had hit the local stations. I grabbed my tablet from the coffee table and clicked through to the news affiliate. A reporter with light brown hair and a station jacket protecting her dress from the fog spoke dramatically to the camera. Our developing story tonight from Westham on the Cape. A local businesswoman found a body on the Shining Sea Bikeway. We're here in front of Mackenzie Almeida's bicycle shop on Main Street. The view zoomed onto the front of my shop, then back to the reporter. The police suspect foul play. I groaned. Wonderful. Not exactly the kind of free publicity I'm looking for. Ms. Almeida was apparently walking home from a meeting when she literally stumbled over the body, the reporter went on. Westham Police Chief Victoria Leighton says her department is cooperating with both the State Police Detective Unit and the Barnstable County Bureau of Criminal Investigation on the case. Authorities are not releasing the victim's identity pending notification of next of kin, but one source says he was a handyman. The camera switched to a shot of the lights and police tape on the bikeway behind my house. Various personnel conferred, knelt on the trail, did whatever police did after a murder. Not a scene I want to relive. I pressed the power button.
You're going to be fine, Mac. Who knows, maybe you'll get an influx of customers from all this.
Tim stroked my cheek.
Look on the bright side.
I wasn't sure how he could be so optimistic, but I was too tired to care. I yawned and extended my hand. Take me to bed, handsome.
Shh.
He tilted his head toward Belle's cage.
We don't want her to learn that one.
Chapter 4. I dragged myself out of the covers at 6:30. Tim had left at his usual 4 o'clock to get the bakery going, and I was due to stop by Jin's Salty Taffy's candy shop at 7 for our walk. Having found a body last night put a damper on my mood, though, despite the morning sun shining through the wide, foot-high, clear-story window at the end of the loft. At least the fog had burned off early today, or had blown through, more likely. Standing on the steps, I made my bed, smoothing the multicolored quilt my grandmother, Abo Reba, had made to welcome me back last year. She'd found cotton fabrics with prints representing many of my experiences and influences up to that point. Softballs flying, whimsical dollar signs, bicycles in all colors, a lighthouse, a Thai riverboat, even a stylized map of the Cape Verdean Islands off the coast of West Africa. This morning, the cheery coverlet didn't cheer me in the least. I zipped through a high-speed shower, put in my contacts, and wiped down the shower walls and sink. I threw on shorts and a long-sleeved t-shirt before lifting the cover from Belle's cage and opening her door. She hopped onto my shoulder, her red tail rustling. "Good morning, Mac. I love you." She nipped my wet locks. "Hmm." A little smile pulled itself onto my face, despite how I was feeling. "Good morning, Belle. I love you, too." This bird, with her eerily human voice, could always lift my mood, even if only for a minute. "Can I have a kiss?" I pursed my lips and leaned my head toward her. She made a kissing sound. Her curved beak moved, but the sound came from farther down in her neck.
"Can I have a kiss?"
she echoed. I smacked my lips again. "Now hop down. I have work to do." I threw a coffee pod into the machine. I usually didn't cut my departure this close, but I had to get that swig of caffeine into me before I left the house. Next up was to feed and water Belle, brace my bad knee, tie my sneakers, and add enough milk to the mug so I could down the Java in record time. Dark heart or not, I made sure everything was tidy before I left. I've been called a neat freak, but really, I just like things to be in order. A place for everything and everything in its place is one of my favorite aphorisms. It's pretty much a requirement for living in a tiny house anyway. My choice of residence is like living on a boat without the motion, and when one or two things are left lying around, the whole place looks messy. 10 minutes later, I set out on Westham's Main Street, arms swinging, water bottle in a waste pack, EpiPen bag across my chest. After a near-fatal encounter with a wasp a few years earlier, I never went anywhere without a double dose of the medicine. Since the little embroidered bag also held my phone, it was a handy accessory. In my pocket were my single house key and the tiny Swiss Army knife I never left the house without. You never know when you might need one. I wasn't a Girl Scout, but I like to be prepared. To the right of my shop was the Lobster Shack, which was a mostly takeout seafood restaurant, not a lobster shack at all. And then both my father's white church and the red-doored Episcopal church across from it. Today, I'd also tucked earbuds in my bag. During our first walk, after a book group meeting, Jin and I each listened to the audiobook of the mystery for the next week's book group meeting. After our first day of listening simultaneously, Jin and I finished either listening to or reading the mystery on our own so we could talk during our walk. But I wouldn't press play on Cracked to Death until Jin and I hit the trail, and maybe not even then. Across the street was Tim's bakery, Greta's Grains. He'd named it after his mother, even though the retired professor now lived on St. John Island in the Caribbean. He told me she taught him to bake, and it was his way of saying thanks. Right now, the alluring scent of fresh-baked baguettes, batards, and brioches floated out of Greta's open front door, but I didn't have time to pop in and say hi. I blew a kiss in that direction, earning me a puzzled look from the driver of a convertible who drove by at that exact moment. Oops. The police department and fire department sat beyond the bakery. A good-sized man of about 50 in a square-hemmed, short-sleeved shirt climbed out of a state police cruiser. Dark hair skirting his collar, he carried a cardboard holder of coffees into the police station. I'd never seen him before, and could only surmise he was working on Jake's death. Or maybe he was Victoria's husband, delivering a dose of decent Java. I'd heard she'd recently remarried, but I didn't know the new spouse. On my side of the street were more charming shops and the century-old red brick and white pillared town hall, which housed the library and a new addition to the right. The town green spread out in front of the municipal buildings. I hurried on, spying salty taffies ahead. Jen stood on the sidewalk in front of her place. She had both hands on the brick wall and one leg extended behind her, stretching her hamstring.
"Sorry, I'm late," I called.
I would have jogged to her, except the knee I'd blown out a couple of years ago in New Zealand made running pretty much of a prohibited activity. It also prevented me from biking. Kind of ironic for a bike shop owner. Power walking was all I could manage, and even that I did with a black brace supporting the joint. She waved and waited for me, switching to stretch her other leg.
"You ever gonna get that knee fixed?" she asked.
"I don't have time, and I don't want to have surgery. Too much could go wrong."
"You mean you're scared of it?"
She tied her thick, expertly colored chestnut hair back with a covered rubber band. Jin and I had met when I'd stopped into her candy shop on a visit home 10 years ago when I was living in Boston. She was only 2 years older than me, but already had a daughter and a divorce behind her. We somehow got to talking about reading mysteries and struck up a friendship. She now knew me well enough to gently rib me about my weaknesses. Maybe. A little. When she poked me with an elbow, I caved. "Okay, yeah, I'm scared. The prospect is too messy. Very disorderly, at least from a patient's point of view. IVs, anesthesia, blood, pain, narcotics, scars? Forget it."
"It's your body. As long as you can still walk with me, I don't care what you decide. Ready?"
I nodded, and we set off past the two churches that bookended the other end of Westham's main drag. Catholic on the right, Quaker on the left. The former's ornate spires, stained glass set into complicated brickwork, and arched doorway contrasted sharply with the other building's simple design. Silvered cedar shingles, and clear windows both tall and wide. The cutover to the bike trail at this end of town was next to the cemetery beyond the Friends' meeting house. Jin hadn't mentioned Jake Lacey, so she must not have turned on the news. When I saw her about to pop in her earbuds, I touched her arm. "Can we talk today instead of listening?"
"Sure. What's up?"
We turned onto the path in the direction of the lower cape, or, as we said, down cape, meaning toward the elbow. Cape Cod looked a lot like the classic bicep-flexing pose of the strongman. The upper cape was the upper arm running west to east. The point of the elbow hit at Chatham, the forearm stretched north, and the hand curled around artsy, colorful Provincetown. The appropriately named Westham sat near the western reaches of the peninsula. After we passed the log body models of deer lining the path and the entirely realistic black dog sculpture, complete with red neckerchief at the back of someone's property, I cleared my throat. "On my way home last night, I found a dead person."
"Whoa, whoa, whoa!"
She stopped and faced me.
"You did? Who was it?"
"Jake Lacey. I tripped over him on the trail behind my house. It was so foggy I didn't see him."
"And he was dead?"
This time she whispered, her mouth pulled down in a horrified look. "Definitely. I called 911, but it was awful, Jin."
"Geez, I'll say. He wasn't that old. Did he have a heart condition or something?"
By unspoken agreement, we resumed walking.
"No."
I pictured Derrick's knife again.
"Somebody had stabbed him. Right here in Westham?
Crap." A bike bell dinged behind us.
"On your left,"
a voice called out a few seconds before three women pedaled by us on the other side of the yellow center line. They rode bright red Schwinn reproductions that looked like rentals, maybe from Joe's in North Falmouth. My 7-speed rentals were sunflower yellow and baby blue. Not a helmet among the ladies, but as long as they stayed off the roads, the trail was level enough that they were probably safe.
But you shouldn't tell anyone about that particular detail, I said.
I probably shouldn't have revealed it, actually. The police asked me not to talk about the scene.
Oh well. What was done was done.
Except, even though Jin and I had been friends for years, I decided not to tell her I thought it was my brother's fish-gutting tool. I trusted her completely, but the knife thing was just too personal. I cleverly managed to tell Victoria that I'd had a disagreement with Jake at our neighbor's table earlier in the day.
You mean Chief Victoria Leighton?
Yep. She insinuated I might have killed Jake myself.
You?
Jin hooted.
That seems pretty extreme, and talk about messy.
I know. Tim said maybe Jake was blackmailing somebody, and that person got fed up and murdered him. The trail opened up to a marshy area, with a bridge leading over what looked like a pond, but was really an inlet from Buzzard's Bay. A fragrant clump of coastal roses were in new bloom, and purple martins darted over the water, catching bugs mid-flight. I voiced the thought that had been top on my mind since last night. I obviously didn't kill Jake. So the question is, who did? Jin stopped again, grabbing my hand.
You know what this means, don't you?
We're going to be in the middle of our very own cozy mystery. You're the protagonist, or we both are.
Her eyes gleamed.
Maybe the book group can help us figure out who the murderer is.
Jin, get real. I shook my head. Hard.
That's why we have police and real detectives. It's their job to solve crimes, not ours. What do we know about real-life murder?
Nothing. Chapter 5. I took a moment before I left for the shop to call Derrick, but he didn't pick up. I'd see him at work soon enough, but in case a lot of people were around, I wanted to talk to him about his knife in private first. No such luck. By a little after 9, I'd already set my open flag in its holder, wheeled out 2 blue and 2 yellow rentals to the front, and paused to admire the shop I loved so much. I took great satisfaction in running my own business, a huge change from the stressful world of finance and working for a boss that I'd been immersed in previously. The left half of the shop was devoted to repairs and the right half to rentals and retail, with shelves and displays full of bright biking jerseys, gloves, shorts, tune-up kits, and the bicycles themselves. Everything was in its place, just how I liked it. But now it was time for me to get to work. Within minutes, I'd returned a tuned-up, recumbent bike to a local lawyer and rented bikes to a German family of 4.
No, we don't need helmets.
The mother had poo-pooed the idea in slightly accented English, the European way. Children under 16 have to wear them, though, I pointed out. State law. She agreed with a frown, and I had them sign the standard disclaimer.
We heard about the crime,
the father lowered his voice.
Will it be safe for us to ride on the shining sea trail?
I winced inwardly. It seemed mercenary of me, but I hoped Jake's murder wouldn't turn people off biking. However, the path where I'd found Jake was still closed off with yellow police tape. Yes, you can't use the closest access path, but you can get to the trail just down beyond the big white church. I pointed on the map. A minute later, I watched them pedal happily away, the adult's hair ruffling in the breeze. Last week, a Danish couple had explained that because so many people in their country bicycled on lanes separated from auto traffic, helmets weren't necessary. I'd urged them to use extra caution on our streets and roads, since the only exclusive lanes here were the bike and pedestrian paths, and they were separate from where cars and trucks traveled. Now, where was my brand new mechanic? I'd hired a local woman, Orlean Brown, to help me with the bike repairs. I'd realized last summer I couldn't handle running both sides of the business, plus have anything like a personal life without help. Operating Mac's bikes included ordering parts, buying new bicycles and accessories to sell, doing the books, keeping up the building, and dealing with the public, besides the basic repair and maintenance work. Derrick had agreed to work on the rental and retail side, but he hadn't shown up this morning either. Where could he be? I really needed to talk with him about the knife. I texted him, but my phone remained silent in return. I stood still for a moment, gazing out the open door. Trees had leafed out, and the swamp azalea was blooming, its pink and white blossoms fragrant. A salty breeze floated in, tangy and fresh. An oriole warbled from a branch. A carpenter hammered away at a project somewhere in the distance, and visitors in bright shorts and relaxed expressions moseyed toward Tim's Bakery for a breakfast pastry. All up and down Main Street, shopkeepers were opening doors, hanging out flags, expecting a profitable day. Westham, the town where I'd spent my childhood, appeared nothing short of an idyll. Except this morning, it was nowhere near idyllic. A man had been murdered. A killer wandered around free. And Jin was nuts if she thought we were going to solve this crime. Still, my brain was already in high gear, trying to put the facts into some kind of order. The best way I could facilitate that was to put my hands to work and let my brain crank away on its own in the background. The most urgent repair ticket was another tandem, and all it needed was a simple tune-up. I'd tied on a repair apron, hoisted the bike onto the arm of the workstand, and selected the wrench I needed from the blue cylindrical tool caddy on top of the stand. I was about to set about my checklist when Orlean hurried in. She was a taciturn woman with tired, straw-colored hair peeking out of her Orlean's Firebird's cap, the headgear worn by fans of the summer Cape Cod League baseball team. I'd never seen her flustered until now.
Sorry, I'm late. Mac, it's my...
She finished with a stream of swear words ending with X. An X. I knew nothing about her home life. As far as I knew, she lived alone. Nobody needed a rotten ex. I'd had a couple, not husbands, but long-term boyfriends, and was relieved to have finally found Tim, who was, at least so far, both easygoing and self-sufficient. Orlean shook her head, eyes aflame.
I can't believe I ever married him. The no good...
She cut herself off. Well, you don't want to hear about that. Anyway, I'm here.
She shoved a paper lunch bag in the little fridge in the corner.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.